Hello, I am Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this episode, I'm going to cover designing the layout of home mining heating systems. Next up is Fold. Fold offers a really cool Bitcoin debit card where you can get rewards in sats from your normal day-to-day spending. I've been using the Fold card for over a year now, and I've already accumulated almost 1 million sats without changing any of my normal spending habits. The card works with the Fold app, where you can buy and sell Bitcoin, buy gift cards, and set up direct deposits and payments, making it super easy to live on a Bitcoin standard. And if you sign up now using the affiliate link below, Fold will give you a bonus reward of 20,000 sats on your very first Fold card purchase. The Fold card is a great way to start living on Bitcoin. Just click the affiliate link below to get started today. Next up is SaaS mining. Now, the focus of this channel is home mining, but let's face it, home mining isn't for everyone. Maybe your power costs are too high, maybe you live in an apartment, or maybe you just don't have enough time or expertise to build a home setup. In any of those cases, SaaS mining is for you. SaaS mining offers Bitcoin mining as a service. You pay for the miners and a monthly service fee, which includes electricity costs, and SaaS mining takes care of the rest. In return, you get a monthly Bitcoin payout from your miners, which allows you to build your Bitcoin stack at a discount. And if you act now and click the affiliate link below, you can get a $50 discount on every miner you buy. If you're looking for hassle-free Bitcoin mining, SaaS mining is a fantastic option. Okay, so when integrating Bitcoin miners into a home, there might be a number of different opportunities for mining heat use. You might have a heat exchanger heating your water or your pool, you might have a radiator heating your air, or you might have a dry cooler dissipating extra unused heat into the environment. And so a huge part of system design is routing hot fluid where you need it to use that heat. Now, the technology used to route hot water through a home is called hydronic heating, and it's been around for over 100 years. And although it's a very mature technology with lots of information out there, using Bitcoin mining as a heat source adds a couple new wrinkles. And so I want to focus on a couple topics that I think are important to consider when designing a home Bitcoin heating system. Now, in putting this episode together, I borrowed heavily from the Caleffi Idronics series of articles. I've mentioned these in past episodes, and they are a fantastic resource for any hydronic design you might be taking on. I highly recommend you give them a look. I've put a link below, and if you surf around the website, you'll find tons of other information there as well. Now, the first topic to cover deals with how to route fluid around your home. And the way I like to frame this is to split this into a couple different general architecture types. The first is what I'll call equal temperature heat use, and the second is what I'll call a heat use hierarchy. In the first of these types, equal temperature, the goal is to ensure that each part of the heating system gets equal access to the heat generated by the miner. In a typical design using this architecture, you have larger diameter hot and cold trunk lines, which then have smaller lines between them, delivering heat to heating devices such as heat exchangers and radiators wherever they are needed. Sometimes this is accomplished using centralized manifolds, but this also can be done in a more distributed setup where the larger diameter trunk lines are routed around the home. The big advantage of this type of architecture is that each heating device sees the same temperature drop, and that temperature drop is as large as it can be. Now, the temperatures involved in Bitcoin mining aren't that high, so this architecture can really help all the heating devices see the maximum temperature differences. Another advantage with this architecture is the individual heating devices can be throttled or turned on or off independently of each other. For an example, let's say you had a home with both a hot tub heater and a home heating radiator. You want both of these to use as much heat from the mining system as possible, but you might not want to always have a hot tub running, and you'll definitely want to turn off the heat radiator during the summer months. This architecture makes this type of system possible. Now, one of the big differences between normal hydronic setups and Bitcoin mining setups is in Bitcoin mining, we want the temperature of the fluid returning to the miner to be as low as possible. If one or more branches allows the fluid to return to the miner without giving off enough heat, you could get heat returning to your miners where it can build up and overheat your mining setup. Now, this can be easily prevented. A simple balancing valve or thermostatic valve can be added to each branch just prior to joining the cool trunk line to control the fluid flow. I'm a huge fan of thermostatic valves. They are a simple and reliable set it and forget it technology, and I've covered an example of how this could be used in my garage heater episode. I've got a link below if you want to give it a watch. Now, the second type of system architecture, which I'm calling heat use hierarchy, has the heating components piped together in series. The first component gets the hottest fluid and absorbs as much heat as it can, and then the second component gets what's left, and so on. Now, the advantage of this setup is each component gets access to the full heating capability of the miners. With the lower temperatures of Bitcoin mining, this architecture might help to focus all of that heat on a single high priority use. For an example, let's say you want to focus on heating your domestic water supply. Putting a brazed plate heat exchanger first in line before sending the fluid to other components will ensure hot water heating always has priority over other heat uses. And if you want to learn more about how to size a heat exchanger for this type of application, I have a link below to my heat exchanger episode. And for another example of this architecture focused on successful mining, putting a dry cooler as the last component in series to your setup can always ensure the fluid temperature is always brought down low enough to keep your miners cool. Now, there are a couple downsides with this hierarchy architecture. First, as the fluid flows through each component, the temperature will get lower and lower, making it more and more difficult to get heat out. This may limit how many different components can be used in series. Second, since all of the fluid is flowing through all of the components, you have to ensure the combined resistance to fluid flow doesn't get too high, or you might have to use a really big and really expensive pump to make this architecture work. Now, these two system architectures can also be mixed and matched. For a real-life example, in my home, all of the glycol water mixture coming from my mining setup first passes through a heat exchanger. This heat exchanger provides hot water and heating for my home, which is the priority for my design. A little further down the line, I have a branch which passes through my garage heater. This heater uses a thermostatic valve to ensure only cool fluid returns to my miner. And at the end of the line, I have my dry cooler. In this design, my heat exchanger and dry cooler are following a hierarchy architecture, whereas my garage heater is using the equal temp or branching architecture. This mixed design ensures that my home gets first priority on heat use, my garage heating can turn on and off as needed, and the fluid returning to my miners is always cooled. Now, I've covered my build in a bunch of other episodes. If you want more details on how I designed and built it, I have a link below to my build playlist. Now, the second topic to cover around system design is something called hydraulic separation. This is a more complicated topic, and I only can cover the simple basics here. Again, there's a whole Caleffi Idronics article on this topic, which will give you a ton more information. I have a link below to that article if you're interested in learning more. But to oversimplify it, hydraulic separation allows you to build a setup where different parts of your system operate at different fluid flow rates. For an example of where this might be useful, imagine that I had a miner tank located a long distance from a building that I wanted to heat using a multi-loop radiant floor. If I tried to build this with a single pipe and piping loop, the fluid lines between the tank and building would have to be very large in diameter, and the pump would have to be fairly massive. This could work, but there is a much cheaper and easier option, and that is to build this as two separate loops with two separate pumps. These two loops are connected using a set of closely spaced T-fittings. The first loop can have a lower fluid flow rate to deliver heat from the tank to the building. This results in smaller lines and a smaller pump. The second loop can have a much higher fluid flow rate, meeting the needs of the in-floor heating system. A set of closely spaced T-fittings hydraulically separates these two loops, but still allows fluid and heat to move freely between them. Now, the obvious disadvantage of building a more complicated setup is, of course, the addition of more pumps and more fittings, and you have to get all of this to work together. So it might be a good idea to work out a few different designs with different architectures to understand which is the best and lowest cost design for your build. And if you're interested in learning more about how to figure out pipe sizing, fluid flow rates, and pressures in system design, I'll be covering that in my next episode, which should show up here when I release it. And you can also hit that subscribe button to make sure you get all new episodes coming your way.